Hi there. In this screencast, we're going to look at some of the features available in ReSharper for C++. ReSharper for C++ comes with support for different kinds of templates. So first of all, we have live templates. These essentially generate snippets of code in your program. Next up, we have surround templates, which let you pick a chunk of code and then surround it with a complete construct, such as an if statement, for example. And finally, we have file templates. Now, file templates let you generate entire files or indeed sets of files, depending on what you choose. So let's take a look at how we can use the class file template to make a class. I'm going to right-click the project here, and I'll choose Add New from Template, and then I'll choose Class. Let's give the class a name, such as Person, for example. And after the template has expanded, what we get is a person.h file with a declaration of class person and a person.cpp file. Now, these templates are totally customizable. We can select this class template and we can press the pencil icon to edit the template. Now we can edit both the header and the CPP file that are generated. So for example, if I want in the header to include a pragma once, I simply type it in like so. And if I want the CPP file to use my precompiled header, I'll include standard afx.h here. Now, all I have to do is save the template and we can start using it once again. So right click the project, add new from template, class. Let's call this one ball. And as you can see, we get a ball.h file, which has the pragma once, and we get ball.cpp, which now has an additional include statement. ReSharper comes with extensive coding assistance mechanisms, making sure that you can type things faster and more efficiently. So for example, if I want to go over all the values in the array, all I have to do is type for each and expand this live template. Now here I simply specify the actual values and what collection we're iterating over. Notice I get completion here too. And this is possible through the power of live templates. So in the Templates Explorer, we can see that ReSharper comes with 20 live templates for C++. And they include common things like writing something to the standard output stream, generating the main method for your application, generating a namespace, and so on. All of these live templates are available in C++ files, and you can always press the pencil button to edit one of these templates and customize it to your liking. Now, when it comes to code generation, ReSharper is also very efficient. For example, let's try making a person class. First of all, we'll use a file template, and notice I'm firing it up with a shortcut here. I'm using a file template for a class. I'm going to call this class person. So now that I have my class, I can make a few fields here. I can make, for example, a name, and I can have an age. Let's get that string into stdString. Notice I get an include statement up above. And now let's suppose that I want to generate a constructor. I can bring up the generate menu by pressing Alt Insert, and I can generate a constructor. So here, all I have to do is specify the fields that I want to initialize. We'll select all of them, and I can choose how exactly I want to pass the parameters. Once I'm done, I press Finish, and here is my constructor. And in a similar fashion, if we open the generate menu once again, you will see that ReSharper comes with plenty of other things that you can generate, including copy and move operations, generating getters and setters for your fields, generating equality and relational operators, generating the stream output operator, which is useful for printing something to the standard output, for example, as well as generating hash and swap functions. So these are some of the features that make development with C++ a lot faster when you're using ReSharper. ReSharper comes with a large assortment of refactorings for all your development needs. So let's take a look at some of them. Now, first of all, we're going to look at the most common refactoring that exists, the rename refactoring. So for example, I have a class human here. Let's suppose I want to change the name from human to person. What I can do is I can fire up a refactoring to do exactly that. And there are different ways to do this. One is to invoke a keyboard shortcut directly. Another is to bring up the refactor this menu. Now I'm going to choose rename here, and I'll give this human a new name, like person, for example. After I press return, you'll notice that all the locations where the word human was used are now replaced by person. And we can do the same thing for a field. So for example, if I want to change age to legal age, I can use a keyboard shortcut to bring up the refactoring. And if I type legal here, ReSharper goes off and looks for my settings regarding to naming conventions, and it's offering legal underscore age underscore. So I can pick exactly this value, I can press next here, and now I have the replacement done in all the locations where legal age is used. Another refactoring that's available in ReSharper for C++ is the introduced variable refactoring. For example, here I'm calculating a monthly rate based on an hourly rate by multiplying it by 8 hours in a day and then by 30 days in a month. So what I can do is I can take a chunk of this expression, I can select it, and I can introduce a variable for it. Once again, I'll fire up the refactor this menu, and here I'll choose introduce variable. So I can give this variable a type. I can either use the deduce type, which is int, or I can go with auto. And then on the next placeholder, I can specify the name for the variable. In this case, this will be a daily rate. And we're done. Finally, let's take a look at the extract method refactoring. Here, I'm solving a quadratic equation, and I want to take part of the calculation and do it in a separate function. What I can do is once again bring up the refactor this menu, and I can choose extract method. Here, ReSharper is showing me the variables which are going to be used as parameters to the extracted method, and I can specify a name here. Let me just do that quickly. So now that I've specified a name, I get a preview of the result of the refactoring, and after I press next, ReSharper generates the actual function and also substitutes the call to this function in the right location. Let's take a look at some of the navigation capabilities which are available in ReSharper for C++. So let's begin by looking for a particular type. Let's say I want to find array. Now the goToEverything mechanism in ReSharper by default gives me just about everything that contains the word array. This includes both header and CPP files, the type name, a couple of constructors, and even some type defs. In fact, there is a lot more in this search, and I can press show more items to see every single item. So as you can see, there are 72 different results here and even some macro definitions, and I can double click on one of them to find the exact location. Now, in addition to goToEverything, it is entirely possible to filter the list of items. So for example, let's put array in here, but now let's constrain it to just the file names. So here I have only the CPP and HPP files. I can constrain it to just the type names. So here I have just the type name array as well as some type defs for it. And finally, I can constrain it to symbol names, which will include the name of a class, some constructors, couple of type defs, and even some macro definitions here. In addition to typing the full name, you can type just part of a name. So for example, I can type ITS here, and ReSharper goes off and looks for every type which has these capital letters. So in this case, we get implied term structure. Now I can use keyboard shortcuts to navigate up and down the hierarchy. So for example, I can go up the hierarchy, and I can also get a list of descendants to go to, like for example, flat forward. Of course, it's always possible to just move the mouse over a particular type and press F12 to navigate to that type. Now, if I want to explore the inheritance hierarchy, ReSharper has a window for that as well. So here, I can see all the descendants of yield term structure, and I can expand them and obviously double-click on any of them to navigate to it. And similarly, I can see the parents of yield term structure as well. And you'll see that there's even some multiple inheritance going on here. Now let's take a look at navigation within a file. First of all, there is a menu for searching members just within that file. So for example, within the quanta term structure file, there is a max date that I can go to. And of course, we provide navigation options for moving between declarations and definitions. So if we pick something that has only a definition, like here, I can go to a declaration in many different ways. First of all, I can invoke a shortcut, like so. But I can also press Alt-Enter, and one of the options here would be to navigate to the definition. Incidentally, since this is a function override, I can also choose this option to navigate to the function that we're actually overriding. Finally, it's worth mentioning ReSharper's find usages mechanism. For example, let's suppose I want to know all the locations where evaluation data is used. I can press a shortcut, and ReSharper goes off and looks for every single usage of evaluation date. As you can see, ReSharper found almost 400 usages of this function. So it's grouped them by project, and we can expand any of these projects and click on the actual location where that function is actually being used. On the right here, you can see a preview pane where you get to see the file before you navigate to it. So of course, you can navigate up and down this window, pick the file that you need and the exact location, and double-click on it to go to the actual file. ReSharper comes with an extensive number of inspections and fixes for C++, so let's take a look at some of them. So for example, here I have a cout output statement, and let's suppose I want to add an end line at the end of it all. Now ReSharper does a pop-up, and it tells me that I have to put an std prefix for this to work. So I can click it, or I could have pressed Alt Enter and I do exactly that. Here I have a constructor parameter that's not being used for anything. So what I can do is I can move the mouse over it. Notice it's grayed out because it's not being used right now, but I can press Alt Enter and I can, for example, initialize a corresponding field from this parameter, like so. Here, what I have is a function which returns an int, but doesn't have a return statement. So ReSharper kind of tells me that there is no return statement here. What I can do once again is I can press Alt Enter here and I can add a return statement and put a value here. Next up, we have an example of dangerous operator precedence. This statement may look okay, but in actual fact, the precedence of the question mark operator is not what you'd expect. And we can actually verify that this is the case by doing Alt Enter and turning it from a ternary operator into an ordinary if. And now hopefully you can see what the problem is exactly. Next up, we have a situation where you have a spurious semicolon in the if statement, and this would result in a possibly erroneous empty statement. So here, all we would have to do to fix this is simply get rid of the semicolon. Now, here is an example of how you can manipulate code. So here we have an if-else statement, and we can do a couple of things with it. If you press Alt Enter, you can see that there is an option to replace it with a ternary expression, like so. And another option is to press Alt Enter, and you can invert the if statement, swapping the order of the conditions, like so. Here we have a couple of issues in the following function. First of all, we have redundant round braces around the count open and account balance equals zero. So what we can do is we can get rid of them. And there are actually two options if you press Alt Enter. One is to remove just this instance of redundant parentheses. The other is to remove all the parentheses in the current scope. So we'll do that and notice they're both gone. And finally, let's take a look at an example of what happens when you have a switch on a color which happens to be an enumeration. What you can do is you can press Alt Enter and you can generate the missing case statements. And by the way, if I get rid of one of them, for example, I can go back and I can regenerate the missing statement once again. So these are some of the examples when it comes to ordinary C++. Now let's talk about macros. Now ReSharper fully analyzes what happens with the macros, and it can offer you subtle hints as well as possibilities of actually manipulating them. So for example, what's happening here is I have an invocation of the mad macro, and mad is itself a multiply and add operation. So it's a macro that uses a macro. What I can do is I can actually inline the whole macro right in this location. I can press Alt Enter and you'll see that there are two options here. One is to substitute just a single level macro call. So if I do that, I get a multiply plus Z because that's how mad is defined. However, I can also perform the substitution recursively, expanding every single macro that's involved in this macro. So after I do that, I get simply X times Y plus Z, because if you expand the mad and then you expand the multiply, that's what you would be getting. ReSharper is also very smart when it comes to templates. So here we have a classic kind of case for template metaprogramming. And one of the things I can do is I can, for example, do a static assert on the value of a factorial that would be calculated via template metaprogramming. And notice if I change something here, so if I put 60 here, then ReSharper is complaining. It's saying that this static assert is going to fail. So essentially, ReSharper is capable of expanding the templates recursively and figuring out whether a static assert in this case would work or not. Also notice that if I move the mouse over the actual value, I get a hint as to the final value. So here it's telling me that the factorial of 4 is equal to 24. So this is something that would be typically shown only at compilation time, but here ReSharper is doing it ahead of time and it's giving you the final value. Finally, let's take a look at a feature which is called create from usage. Now create from usage is fairly simple. So let's, for example, make a struct called person. Now, what I can do is I can populate this struct not by writing code inside the struct itself, but rather by using it. So let's make an instance of person. And here I can set the person's age, for example. So I set the person's age, and of course the age field doesn't exist, but I can press Alt Enter and I can create this field. So I'll make a field called age. And similarly, if I want, let's say a name, I can do p.name equals John, for example, and perform the same operation once again. Create a field called name. This time I'll use a string and notice the blue pop-up once again. ReSharper is saying that, well, this is an std string and you have to have an include statement as well. So when I press Alt Enter, that's exactly what I get. And similarly, you can work with functions. So for example, if I want a function called say hello, I can simply write it like so, and once again press Alt Enter and create the appropriate member function. And of course this member function isn't entirely complete because it has to have a body somewhere, but I can press Alt Enter once again and I can either generate the implementation of the function or I can do it in line right inside the structure definition. And these are some of the ways that ReSharper analyzes your code and offers you ways of actually fixing it or improving it somehow. So these are some of the features available for ReSharper for C++, and to find out more, go to jetbrains.com/ReSharper. Thanks for watching.